Smoking dope, it might be a lot of fun right now. Soon, you're gonna learn it teaches you to live in a privately defined world. A world that gets smaller and smaller as you box yourself in, you narrow your options until you're left with absolutely nothing.
That's pretty much cashed. Cashed.
I seen it. It's lurking and it's down.
Welcome to the 14th episode of the Spose podcast. This episode is going to be super dope for multiple reasons. One of them being that we're celebrating Preposterously Dank, my album that I put out 10 years ago today. If I can get this out Monday, February 26th. If it's out the 27th, just imagine it's still the 26th. It's the week. It's the week I dropped my first album 10 years ago, Preposterously Dank, a moment that changed the course of my life, you know, and I'm going to sit down and discuss the fuck out of that album and play some unreleased shit we never put out that I made for the album, and who knows what's going to happen.
Play my theme song.
I just got back from New York. I went down to see the Celtics beat the motherfucking Knicks, even though there's really nobody on the Knicks right now, so I can't, it's not like a brag. But it was dope to see the Celtics at Madison Square Garden. Lots of Celtics fans, super good seats. Shout out to Lee, who is just the fucking man, and he knows it. Go Celtics. This week, I've been contemplating what to do to celebrate the 10-year anniversary of my first album, because it's a big deal to me, or it's big nostalgia. You know, nostalgia is one of the best drugs of all, and it's bittersweet like every other drug, but it's one of the best. So I'm stoked for the nostalgia, but I'm stoked to reconnect with somebody I haven't, you know, I've maybe had like a 10-minute conversation with them in like 8 years, and I got to sit down, you know, for an hour. Last time I saw him was at like the motherfucking, what do you call it? Yarmouth Clam Festival, you know? But I met up with him the other day at the Halo in Wyndham. Shout out to Darren, Elder at the Halo, who is, just the humblest of humble. He let me, I linked up with my man. So I'm just going to get into the interview. I'm going to skip the reviewing an album in 1 minute segment for this week. I'm going to skip Spose Does Sports. I kind of always do sports. Either way, this is an honor to bring on my guest, Matt Robinson, a.k.a. Achromatic, a.k.a. Jim Brown, who helped me get started as a rapper and gave me a chance and mixed my first album and recorded it and made music with me. Here we go. Check, check, check. Okay, I can see my levels. Yeah, just talk a little. Hang on, I'll turn you up because you're notoriously quiet.
Well, now I'm gonna try to be
extra quiet and sad. Let me convert that coffee into a tea for you. No. Okay, so this week we're commemorating Preposterously Dank, my debut album, possible to say it's a cult classic. I don't want to jump to any conclusions because it's my own album, but one of the biggest pieces of that album is my first guest, somebody who I don't know that this album would exist without. He mixed Preposterously Dank, he recorded a lot of Preposterously Dank, made a beat on there, and really was one of the people who kind of made me feel like I could actually pursue rapping to begin with, because he rapped with me back when he was a rapper. So welcome to Spose Podcast, Matt Robinson. Yeah, is that a secret I cannot divulge that you rapped?
I mean, you can definitely divulge it.
You have to talk into the microphone.
I think people are surprised when they hear that. And it's been so long that, like, my son came up to me and he was like, "My mother said that you used to rap."
So he had never known until now.
You're not listening to anything I ever said.
Oh, you wouldn't play it for him?
No, absolutely not.
You weren't bad. You were good.
I mean, it was also like, hey, I'm going to write some stuff. I don't know if anybody's ever going to hear it.
So you and me, I guess we should go to how you and I met each other was in
I started rapping in Maine, and somehow I found out there was a website called mainhiphop.com, and I'm pretty sure that's how I met you. Right?
Yeah, yeah. Or, yeah, that definitely would have been a big sort of organizer at that time for what was going on.
Because it was really no... I wasn't old enough. I must have been 16.
Yeah.
And how old were you? You're maybe like 21 or something?
Yeah. I was 20. Was I working? Do you know if I was working in the old port at that time? Because I
don't know
like
where
20.
You were
yeah.
working.
I want to say I was 20. That's probably about right. 19, 20.
Okay. And so we met through mainhiphop.com, and I was, and then you and I started doing some records together. Did you live in Red Bank with?
I did.
So in South Portland, I think I went over your house, and we were doing joints with Abador and Ghost and Rome and you and all those dudes. We did a joint called 4321, which I might play a clip of right now.
Suppose you've been chose to come and get some. I'm rapping with an empty wallet, scared to go to college. My economics bombing from smoking on all that chronic. You got the notion of the rappers I abolish and demolish.
But,
the ocean,
we did a bunch of joints
solid.
Together, and you were, you know, when we started doing some joints that were like Spose and Achromatic, I think we might have had two or three.
Yeah, absolutely.
With Bad Manners and a bunch of other MCs that were coming up. But I had never really, I guess I always had my eyes set on making an album, on a Spose album.
Yeah,
you know,
which was clear to me.
You saw that? Like, yeah, I guess talk about when we first met and kind of like what you observed. Because you met me pre-Preposterously Dank by maybe 4 years.
Yeah, yeah. And that's something that, you know, I was... For me, as far as like the journey of what we did, I was happy for that to be like basically where it kind of ended, and you kind of went on and did your thing, because I was super happy to like bring you.
You brought me right up
to like that
it's
point.
Like,
I'm so happy to hear you
sending me out
to hear you say like, oh, I can't remember exactly the way you said it, but basically the reason. And I just, you needed motivation. You just needed somebody that was going to say like, here's a place to record.
I need validation.
Just like
maybe
I don't know. I wish people could have heard what I heard back then, and they can in a lot of ways, but it was obvious to me that you had, like, you were in pocket most of the time, your content was straight, like the work ethic was there. Like, it was all the things that you'd look for, like in a, hey, I'm trying to make a underground rap thing work.
Yeah,
you know what I
mean?
Like,
yeah.
Not a complete mess. Like you're, I mean, you know, you were single at the time, whatever.
I was definitely
like
a reckless like kid, but
in the spectrum of like,
I wasn't on heroin.
No, absolutely not. And there were some people that, you know, you wouldn't know if they would show up to the studio or not. I knew you would always show up. So when it came time, you know, further down the road to have a shop, I knew that if I, you know, set it up, you would come, you know?
I think for me, it was really like, because I was rapping in my high school in Wells, which is a, you know, we have like 600 kids in our high school. Yeah. And it's, you know, I'm feeling very validated in that environment. But I really, it was like I wanted the people in Portland, which is,
sure,
you know, just as you would if you're in any suburb of a big city, you want the people in that city to validate you.
Yeah.
You know, and I just remember feeling very validated in myself outside of, because we started doing it almost as a joke and for fun.
Yeah.
I always wanted to do music, but when I started linking with you, I played my first show with you.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
We opened for the Porn Theater Ushers.
Yeah.
At the Center for Cultural Exchange, which still exists today as One Longfellow Square. Yeah. Years later, I did a Spose Unplugged show there to come full circle.
Yeah.
I guess, go ahead.
I mean, it's just interesting to hear you say that was like a validating thing, because for me it was like I could see how from your perspective, like, oh, I'm coming from Wells, going to Portland, up to the whatever, from the class D to class C or whatever.
We were class B. I don't know what happened to Wells after I left, but now they're class D.
but no, I mean, I just saw somebody that was like, yeah, you're from out of town or whatever, but you're here and you're for the most part pretty clearly outperforming most of the people that are. You know, you just had a good head on your shoulders as far as like making rap music goes. So, when I, you know, you're finding forums, you're finding people to make like mixed tapes with, mixed tracks, and like putting four people on one song and trying. It was like anytime you were involved, I knew it was going to be like a decently well put together thing. At the very least, you were going to show up. You know what I mean? So I'm traveling all over these places with, you know, a mic stand and a condenser mic
and a PC
not much
tower.
More than this, really. Actually, probably even less than what we have now.
Yeah.
To record tracks, because I know you're going to show up. I know it's going to be good stuff. I know eventually it's going to, if the right person, you know, you.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so somewhere in there, you know, we started doing our shows, and I guess the big point about the pre-preposterously dank stuff is just to say that, you know, you were a big piece of me feeling validated enough to pursue it to that degree, you know, and so by the time I got to college, there's actually a fairly infamous picture that I hope never sees the light of day where I was in, like, a brief, like, total wigger phase where I'm in a bandana under a hat, oversized white t-shirt, and showed up to, I think it was like Blue or something, some club, to play some awful show with you and Ghost. And I remember Ghost was like, all right, go roll this joint. And I went in the bathroom. I like, couldn't do it. It was like real sad. But there's a picture of us. You look cool. And I look bad. And but this was college, the beginning of college for me, which is sad that I looked like that. But or that I was faking, you know, I was trying to fake some front end thing to be a rapper. I don't think the walls weren't as broken down as they are now, where you can be a rapper and look like anything.
Right. Yeah.
I thought there was like one archetype of what a rapper looked like, and it was like Eminem.
Yeah.
You know, is what I thought I could look like. And so, I remember about college, when I started college, is when I started writing these records, for this album, or began working on it. And I'd say it was about a 4-year span. You know, they say your first album takes your whole life and your next album takes like a year, you know, and that's very true because this one took years and years. But around that time, started working with Eric Doms down in Alston. He was doing some production and some, he was recording too.
Right. But it is, I think it's important to mention that he was up here too.
Yeah. He's from Maine.
Right.
That's how I knew him was actually through you. I want to say, we went out, and I remember we had to like take our shoes off because it was his mom's house, and we were up in his room. And I brought like a couple kids from Wells High School, Ian Maxwell and Trevor Brown, actually, or who I brought with me. And you know, they wanted to sit in for the record. And I remember like his walls were like kind of sloped, and it was like kind of small, but it was like that's where we were recording. But I knew Eric from Maine through you, which is just to say the serendipity of like all of it kind of fell into place by the domino starting to fall by me pursuing it, me finding mainhiphop.com, me putting myself out there and finding you. And you at the time, I'd say you were trying to pursue being a rapper. Am I wrong? That was like, or you just weren't, or you were doing it as a hobby, or you were kind of into the whole thing.
I enjoyed all of it. I knew, if I had to pick, I was trying to produce and
make
record.
Beats.
I wanted to make beats and I wanted to record people, like be the support, be the backbone there. That's really what I enjoyed. I like rapping too, but I didn't really have the, I mean, I don't know. We could debate that, I suppose, but like, I don't know. I enjoyed the production bit of it more for sure.
So your production alias was Jim Brown.
It was, yeah.
Still is, might be. I don't know if you got any beats lurking. You're gonna
no, but I still play a lot of video games by the same
by the same name, Jim Brown, the Vegas name,
Mr. Jim Brown. If you see me playing, you know, Overwatch or whatever.
Okay, yeah. Video games come up a lot on the Spose podcast, and I don't play them, but I have like a list now. I was like, I guess I need to play Fortnite. And I guess I need to play Overwatch, and I guess I need to play, you know.
You don't have to. You could also just keep your shit
I
together
won't.
As an adult.
Yeah.
You know, like that's probably a better path to take.
I don't
take.
Know how I'm going to find the time to play them, but there are moments where I'm like, wow, this is the moment right here where I'm about to like smoke some weed and jerk off.
Yeah.
Should I do that or should I go play the video games?
And lately, not a lot of video game playing.
Yeah, barely any. So I've bought. So I guess. Let's talk about the album, because it's like this album, you know, is what started it all for me. And if it wasn't for me doing this album and you helping me get there and you not charging me that much, I don't know if I ever would have got in the game. You know,
did I?
You charged. It was a lot to me at the time, but like knowing what I know knowing what I know now, it was pretty much a bargain.
Yeah. No. So I don't know if it was obvious at the time, but I feel like it should have been. Maybe it just never went being stated, but pretty much the only reason for getting that space was so you could record that album.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, what am I, how much money, to be honest. All right. So I'm at the time I was working in Hannaford overnight. So I was pulling in, you know, a couple hundred dollars a week or whatever. I wasn't like I don't have the skill set, the certifications, the qualifications, or the resume to start pulling in like business enough to quit my day job.
It was under a dentist office or like a medical practice,
maybe like
or
an insurance agency. Or
so it was
something.
In the basement.
Yeah, but it was definitely.
That.
But it was you know it was
nice
business zoned. Yeah. You know, so this was definitely not like your mom's. Basement. You
it
know?
Was it, so well for me. It felt like such a huge step up because I came from recording at Eric Dom's house with the slope wall or in my bedroom,
right?
You know, doing music. And so, you this made me feel so like it was for real. You know, it was like it, I would get out of work even. I think at the time I was working at Barnacle Billy's as a cook, and I would get out of work, you know. 10:30, 11, and you'd be willing to meet me there, you know, quarter of midnight and record till 2 a.m. And you even actually after I put out the album, you let us have a couple band practices there, which was great. And but just to say there was this place called Small World, you know, is what you were calling. I still have bumper stickers and you
I just love the plaque.
Yeah. And so it was your studio, you know, and you had a booth and you were recording, and I want to say that's where you mixed Preposterously Dank was there. And I remember going in there, but let's say this album actually started before Small World.
It did,
I think
yeah.
you got the studio yeah. maybe to drive home Preposterously Dank.
Yeah. Because it was being sort of piecemealed, I think. And it seemed like, and maybe in hindsight, this is way too much like clarity and like compared to what was actually happening at the time.
Yeah.
But you know, we were recording, obviously not in all these places at the same time because I lived in all these places, but like my girlfriend's living room.
Yes.
There was the Red Bank apartment, which would have been quite a while
which
ago.
Is way
but there
back,
was also another, I don't know if you, there was another apartment in South Portland.
I remember your one in Portland on Winter Street.
There as well. So that's like, okay.
That's
so that's one. That's
one
my, that
girlfriend.
Was my girlfriend's place, right?
And then, I remember you had a sheet up to block the kitchen to
yeah.
change the reverb maybe.
Yeah,
it was
something
like the
that.
Thought.
Yeah.
And like,
But yeah, so I mean, we were recording basically in a bunch of different places wherever it sort of made sense at the time. And it just seemed like, you know, I was working, I had like an extra, you know, $80 or whatever to spend on a rent for a studio. It's something I wanted. I wanted to be able to have that space. You know,
yeah.
I was, you know, to be fair a little bit, you know, I'd want to have a space where I could maybe make beats, do that type of thing for myself.
Play video games too.
Play video games. We did that, quite a bit. Ian, it's worth mentioning, Ian did kind of go in halves on that with me. We were working at Hannaford together. So
shout out to Ian Jones, who was there a lot of like the final days of Preposterously Dank when I was like, maybe like, I think we redid the song Justin MC and you did a new beat to it. But I think you did that beat by like maybe muting the other beat. And producing around my vocals, I'm not exactly sure, but it's called
yeah.
Justin MC 2 because the original version was like an upbeat breakbeat.
Oh yeah, yep. I had the vocals to go off of because you would record it on a different
and
beat.
And then I think re-recorded with your, which is still something I do today,
yeah.
where I'll record. Even just recently, I made a whole song over this beat that's kind of just like a drum break and like a chord thing, and I muted the drums and produced all around it. I still do that to this day.
Yeah.
But the shout out to Ian Jones, who was there for Preposterously Dank, is one of the only people who was there. It was him, and I remember me and Cam Groves went over to your girlfriend's apartment on Winter Street in Portland that we were talking about, and it was the middle of the day. I remember because it was like days off were precious.
Yeah.
You know, and I was in college, so it was like I was only in Maine really at Christmas break. And well, actually, I was in Maine frequently because I liked being in Maine, but I was, I think it was a day in the summer, and we were at your apartment, and Cam came, and this was Cam's big moment. You know, this was like I'd known Cam as a rapper since I was like 14, but this is the first time he ever got on a song at a place that wasn't my bedroom.
Yeah.
You know, this is like a big deal. And so that song was John Madden that we did there, produced by Eric Doms.
I think, yeah.
Pretty sure Eric Doms produced that. And that was where the infamous TJ quit voicemail happened, where I got a phone call as I was recording John Madden, and you just happened to have the mic on. And this, to this day, I actually just did a Q&A episode like 5 episodes ago, and that was one of the questions. Why did TJ quit? People all want to know why TJ quit. Do you remember that?
I remember the phone call. I remember it making its way onto the album. I don't remember why TJ quit, though.
We may never know. No, I'm just kidding. I said it on that podcast, but just to squash this once and for all, TJ, we had a boss at Barnacle Billy's, and it was only so shocking to me that TJ quit because I just had worked with him yesterday, and I worked with him 80 hours, 60, 70 hours a week for the whole spring and summer. And I was like, what, TJ quit? And it was Peanut, who was our boss, calling me. He was trying to get me to come in to work. He's like, TJ just quit in the middle of the day. Will you come in? And I was like, oh, man, I was at your house recording.
Portland recording songs.
Yeah. And so TJ, I think, was just sick of the shit where you it's like a job where, like, you have to shave and you have to have your shirt can't look dirty. And it's like they take it way too serious. And TJ was like, fuck this shit. And he just quit. Shout out to TJ, who I remained friends with after he quit. I haven't seen him in a few. I saw his brother on Halloween or something, but TJ's still around. Shout out to TJ. TJ Karolidis is his name. But I remember specifically recording John Madden there. I think that's the only song I really remember doing there.
I think we tried to do some stuff for Drugs, Girls, Money, Liquor there.
Okay.
Maybe didn't quite make the cut, but yeah.
Okay. Yeah, there is like, and I think if you go listen to the vinyl version of Preposterously Dank that's out there, or the cassette remaster I put out, because I've already beat this album to death. It's the 10-year anniversary. I've already worn it out. Yeah. But the remastered version, I think, has this extra 16 bars at the end of Drugs, Girls, Money, Liquor that was like, they don't want me rapping to mass in the cheddar cheese. Da-da-da-da. I don't remember the bars, but it was like that. For some reason, I think we muted it on the album.
Yeah.
And it's just funny, the little things that didn't make the record or did make the record. And there's a few things I'm actually going to play at the end of this episode that are snippets that didn't make it.
All right.
You know, I got this one track I remember called Satan's in the Basement that I may have recorded with you or not.
I don't think so.
Because I also had a mic, but it wasn't not, like my mom bought me I think it was a Behringer B2. It was like the shittiest condenser mic you can have. And I had it. And I was, so a lot of the songs I did record, some of them myself, maybe Goddamn.
Yeah, there were definitely two or three that you brought to me that were already recorded.
Yeah,
like you
a couple of them I think I recorded with Eric Doms.
Yeah. Oh, right, yeah.
Because he had a studio set up too.
Yeah. I gave away, I don't know if it was the same mic that we would have used then, but I gave it away just like 6 months ago because it was sitting in a box.
Who'd you give it to?
Just a guy I work with that likes to record stuff and wants to put stuff on the radio up there, you know. And he mentioned, oh yeah, I'm gonna try to go find like a cheap, dynamic mic, right? And I was like, let me just dust off. I think I have a condenser.
Yeah,
and he was like, oh man, this is the craziest.
I actually just bought. I mean, back in the day, it was like my equipment was precious. You know, I had the PC tower, and I was recording in maybe Adobe Audition. Is that what you were using too?
Yeah, love that. Fruity Loops too. Shout out to
Fruity Loops. Yeah, I produced a bunch of beats in Fruity Loops. Because at the time, I think Fruity Loops was the only thing I really knew how to produce. You know what's crazy is a lot of big producers now use Fruity Loops.
That makes sense. I feel validated by that. Speaking of.
I did too. I was like, oh, like I guess I could have just used it all along.
Because I tried to use other stuff. And I was like, I want to use Fruity Loops. It's just easier. Like I could, I don't have a whole podcast about Fruity Loops. But
I just watched this video the other day that was the guy who produced Rockstar, the song by Post Malone and 21 Savage. It's like a big record right now.
Yeah.
And he was showing you how he made the beat, and it was literally just eight instruments in Fruity Loops. He's like, all right, so I muted the hi-hat here when there's the snare, and it's like,
check
okay.
This box.
So
check
I
that box.
Yeah. So I felt pretty good about that. Ever since I signed a record deal, I've used, I say signed a record deal because that's the only time I ever had enough money to go buy something. I bought a laptop and I got Logic. Right. And this is only because Jerry at the Apple store told me. I was like, I need Pro Tools. Because that's what I thought. I was like, I need Pro Tools. And he's like, nah, man, you need Logic. And so that's what I got. And I've been using it ever since. And that is to say, I think whatever DAW you use comes down to how well you can convert an idea.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what you use. So Fruity Loops is okay.
And I mean, I was totally fine with using it because one, it was, I paid the education fee.
Right. Oh, yeah, the education version. I have the education version of Dreamweaver.
And I heard somewhere that like who was using it?
Ninth Wonder was using it. Was like a big thing.
Yep, I think that's what it was. Yeah, I was
like, so okay,
if I can rise to that level using it, then I'll be fine.
Yeah, and so you produced on the album. I want to say you produced Justin MC2.
I believe so. Yeah,
and I think that's it, right?
I think so. I'd have to. Yeah.
And we should point out
there were others there.
Some of the other production credits, as I run down the songs, Eric Doms produced Preposterously Dank. Fuck It, maybe was... Oh, Fuck It was Eric Doms, too. John Madden was Eric Doms. Drugs, Girls, Money, Liquor was me. I produced that.
I do remember going, when I look back at the list, I am shocked that Doms has as many on there as he does. It surprises me just because...
Well, why was this album the death of you and Eric Doms' music careers? What did I do? Like, this is like the end of both. Like, Doms was making beats.
I wouldn't look at it that way, though. I would look at it more like, you know, we put the effort in. We, whatever, sowed the oats or whatever. And then we went about doing things that we knew could pay our bills.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like, look at the hustle you've put on. Let's be honest. Like, this isn't because we made Preposterously Dank. We're not here to having this conversation because we made Preposterously Dank.
Kids still talk to me about this record, though. It's like every day, every couple days, somebody's got something to say about you. If I put up, what's your favorite Spose album? This album comes up quite a bit, you know? And I will say, I think a lot of that has to do with the time and place you encounter an album. You know, because I have a soft spot for a lot of albums from 2000 to 2005 because I was in high school and was starting college. You know, and I think we all have stuff like that. And so this album does have a special place to people because maybe when they encountered it.
For sure, yeah.
But,
I mean, how cool was it to be able to record an album and just, I mean, that, just being able to like, hand it out to your friends. I mean, and that's what it was.
That was
right?
What
like
it
you,
was.
You really wanted to make an album that you could, back when CDs mattered, you could give them to your friends and they could take a smoke trip and listen to your album.
Was it. To me was like, and I've always known presentation matters dating back to like, I remember in like eighth grade, we were trying to pick like a theme for our eighth grade something. And it was like every whole bunch of people had ideas, but I was the only one that like drew it up on the paper and like had a design and like an idea and everybody voted for mine. And I was like, oh, all you got to do is come to people with a presentation. And right. I knew that the album, the music's good. I thought I stood by the music and I thought it was really important at the time and everything. But if it wasn't, it didn't look like that, you wouldn't think that. If I handed it to you on a burned CD, you're like, okay, well, this kid's burned CD good, you know? And so I remember walking up to people with Preposterously Dank in my backpack going to rap night. I went to rap night, or it was just the open mic.
Right.
And I remember going... And walking up to, I didn't know these guys, but they were on stage. It was DJ Shade and Boondocks, who to this day are, you know, I just saw Boondocks a couple days ago. I remember just walking up on stage. I didn't know them. I didn't know anybody. I just handed them the CD, and they both hit me up the next day on MySpace to be like, yo, man, this is what? You know, like, because they never heard of me. And it's like, if you come out swinging, and I think that was the big thing for me with this record was to be like, even maybe more than the songs, was I knew from the jump it was going to be on a physical CD with artwork.
Right, right. Yeah, and I mean, there were a lot of things that you did at that time that and I mean, we were, I still feel like that. I was a kid at the time, even looking back at it, but like... And did at the time feel like a kid, but there were a lot of decisions that you made, right? And it was just like one after another. And it was clear that you wanted to put out, like you said, a polished product that if it didn't sound perfect to the core, at the very least, it looked perfect. And it would get people to listen to it. And just the way that the first couple songs are laid out and the way that kind of pulls you in, I mean, that's something you don't see. I mean, with top production stuff these days, you know? And here we have a kid in Maine that's doing it. And it was super fun. And I think what was cool is that the way that, and we had conversations about this, I don't know if you remember, but like the content and stuff, how you just nailed like the perfect mix of like relevancy, but also like, I'm not going to sit here and preach to you guys. Like, going to have some fun with this. This is a rap song. Like, I'm a white dude from Maine and I just want to have some fun with it. And maybe at the end of the day, I can feed my family. And
Never thought that. I know. I mean, I did. Well, to be honest, there's actually an interview. I was trying to dig it up, and if I can find it, I'll throw it at the end of this too. But you did an interview with me at your girl's house when we did that John Madden that day. You did like a little video interview. I don't know you would have filmed it on, but it's me talking about, you were just asking me like, yo, so what do we got to expect from the album? And I was like, you know, and it's 22-year-old, you know, 21, 20-year-old me, you know, where my biggest goal in life was to like maybe have a threesome. You know, it's like, this is like my, like, that was like my full mindset was like smoking weed. And like, and you hear that in the interview, it's like almost like crazy. Like, and it, I will say, it wasn't until I played a show playing these songs that I really kind of understood that like, oh, this could like impact people.
Yeah. Well, it was clear to me. So it's interesting for you to say that, because I mean, as the years went by, and everything seems like a blur at this point, but as the years went by, it was clear that you did, you know, you want. I remember one time having a conversation with you, and I said, and maybe it'll sound poetic, but I said like mediocrity is underrated or something like that. I don't know if you remember that, but no. Like you were. This was, I think, a little bit after the deal had like maybe not been amazing, right?
Yeah, no, it didn't go great. It was okay.
And I don't know if this was a little bit after the first was born, and maybe there was a little bit of, I don't know.
Doubt? Yeah.
And I was like, and I remember just saying, like, or at least I remember thinking this and trying to convey this to you. If you can make like a middle class income being a rapper from Maine, like, that's not like a mediocre life. Like, I don't feel like that's a fucking fantastic life. And I feel like, I don't know, maybe just most people don't they shoot for the stars. And I'll see like, dude, $55,000 a year will make you can live in Maine for that, you know?
It's a really great point. And it's funny you say that, because that's actually something I think it kind of took me years to really grasp is, I was actually on the way here. I was listening to sports radio, which I fucking hate sports radio. And I don't know why I listen to it, but it's like radio, the rest of the radio sucks. And I don't have Sirius. So it's like, is that not?
That's good.
Okay. You're kind of like an engineer.
It's like a fulcrum situation.
Some sort of fulcrum. There you go. Yeah. Put that weight. We're having mic stand difficulties, but, also shout out to Darren Elder and the Halo for housing us in this sexy ass, like wooden room right now. But I was listening to sports radio on the way here, and the guy goes, and he is interviewing the coach of the Houston college basketball team, like Houston University or something. I don't know. And University of Houston. And he was saying that he tries to make sure their team's doing really well this year. And he goes, I want you to every day remember where we started. You know, like remember that we started in this, you know, last year, and we've built it to this. And like always look back at that and don't judge tomorrow by today. You judge it by then. And it was like, oh, damn, what a great point, because I'm never judging where I'm at now by like where I was when I was 21. I'm always judging it by like where I'm trying to be, right, and I'm where everybody who's more successful than me is. And I do think that's a very like American flaw, that we kind of teach everybody that they can, you know, you can all be, it's like that Brad Pitt quote from Fight Club where it's like, we all want to be rock stars and da da da. And it's like, even for me, it's like, I really do. You know, especially like I had a song on the radio that it was played with all the other songs. I really feel like, oh, I'm validated. I can hang, you know, is like what I think in my head. And like, I sometimes lose track of like just kind of pausing your way up the mountain and looking around and being like, wow, this is awesome.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it's super important to do that. And I think it really is like bad for mental health to like continually have your eyes on the prize so much that you don't see the forest around you.
Yeah, for sure.
I may or may not have like five songs about that on the album. But you know, I appreciate that thought, because I really do, especially as I've kind of got in these last maybe 2 or 3 years, and maybe it has something to do with being 30. I think there's like something about the milestone of like getting to your 30s and like almost just like exhaling in a way for me, you know, and it was like just kind of realizing like, oh, this is awesome. Like, this is really, I'm really fortunate, and there's something to be appreciated about this. But it's kind of been a steady climb since my, with the, I look at, you know, my I'm Awesome year as like an anomaly, you know, and otherwise has been a steady climb to a decent living. You know, I don't like literally right now, I don't have to do anything. I don't want to do. I don't have a boss and I should appreciate it. And I bet 2000, you know, what were we, 2008 me would be very stoked to know that I am still doing it.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's good to see that you stuck with it. Cause I mean, you could have quit at any point.
There were points where I could
suffocated all of us from all this content that would have later come out.
Yeah.
And you could be, you know, doing, you know, the type of work I do or something much, much less glamorous and, you know, middle of the road, pay the bills, but, that's not who you are. So, yeah. And I mean, that I feel like it was just a work ethic for me. It was like,
that was clear as a 21, 22 year old kid.
It really was. Cause I mean, I guess and this is like maybe the human condition, right? Like you don't really understand what life is like for anybody else. You only can see what it feels like for you. So maybe you felt like, oh, I'm a mess, man. But like
definitely
from the point of view of somebody that sees a bunch of like other people trying to come in and out, make rap songs. It's like, you're not a mess, man. Like it's even like weird things that people say, like you talk about making the album. This is something I'm never going to be able to get out of my head. Just one of those things. But like, I remember people talking about like, how many songs are on that album?
11.
There's 11 songs on that album. There are people I know that would be like, that's worth 11, like X times 11. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Okay.
If it had 22 songs, it'd be worth exactly twice as many dollars. And people it's those types of like little things that I saw where it's like, you never said to me, Matt, we got to make this album has to have 15 songs on it or it's not worth the money. You know,
I did definitely have the vision for 11 songs.
Yeah.
And it was because I thought 12, maybe this speaks to something that like from a young age, I took CDs and music, both rap music, rock music, very seriously. And it was, I was just lamenting the other day that you can no longer judge somebody by their CD collection.
Yeah.
You know, like it used to be like, I can tell whether you suck or not based on what CDs you own. Yeah. Now you got to unlock your phone. And then I can't even still really tell, you know, cause what you listen to today, who knows, you know,
Spotify history maybe.
But my first three albums were all 11 songs on purpose because I felt 10 was not enough. And 12 was pretentious. It was like a pretentious number that's what CDs were supposed to be. So I thought like 11. Oh, well, and maybe there's something to be said. And I really did feel at the time like I was breaking the mold a little bit of what rap music was supposed to. I really did feel like that. You know, I felt like, okay, you're not supposed to shit on yourself. Or like, fuck it. You know, I'm talking about, you know, suburban living, you know, and all these things that like nobody else is really talking about. And I really feel like since then a lot of people have done this, but like, I think it really was, not to say groundbreaking, but I really felt it was, you know, I thought it was. And, when it came out and it was number 9 on like the local sellers like chart, I was like, oh my God, like I made it, you know. I guess talk a little about what you thought once it came out, because I mean, I gave you some copies and maybe you showed some friends, and
I mean, I was super proud of it, you know. I don't know if I had like a bag full of copies to hand out to people, but I was definitely handing it to whoever would listen. And you know, people, you know, at that time, that's who I was too. Like I was the
recorded that album. Yeah.
People were bugging me about it. They wanted it, and everybody loved it. Like it made me very, very proud to be able to just see a finished product. And
I think there's something to be said, man, for just the encouragement you gave me to finish it. Cause it's like, you said, you went and rented a space to kind of just encourage me to finish this record because you believed in it and you heard. I think the first songs I ever made for the album were Drugs, Girls, Money, Liquor and Goddamn. And then the last songs we made for it, which included you playing a vocoder.
Oh, yeah.
Under Control.
I love that song.
Did you produce that?
No. That was, no.
That was Greg Fry.
Yeah.
Greg Fry produced Under Control and Goddamn. And that song.
I did do the talk box on it.
Yes. Yes.
But yeah, no, I love that song. I still listen to that.
I still think that. That was the song from that album that like remained in my set.
Really?
Far into 2012, 2013. Yeah. And now I'll pull out a Drugs, Girls, Money, Liquor first verse of goddamn little bit of fuck it, you know. Also, you know, To the Head is like a song that I produced with this kid I was living with at the time, Chris Quint. Shout out to Chris Quint.
That song blew my mind when you brought that one to me.
Why?
Just because mostly simple guitar riff,
mm-hmm.
right? Looped with a little variation or whatever, but it was it hit a little harder than I was used to, I think, and it was to the head. It was just I loved it.
Yeah,
I was always impressed when you just would bring things to me having never heard them before. And I would be like,
as opposed to being there for the whole creative process.
Yeah. And maybe that just adds to the like feeling of it, you know, like boom. There wasn't much that you brought to me that I didn't like.
Nice.
Done.
Ironically.
Just the one.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember.
Oh, the one?
No, just the one song.
What song?
I'm Awesome.
Oh, I'm Awesome. You were not feeling that one. You're like, man, I don't know about this.
No, I vividly remember being like,
Yeah,
it's a little on the head, but
it's
not.
I bring that to you? Tell me. I don't remember.
It wasn't.
That.
It wasn't. This was after that album was done. You were trying. You did because exactly
I had did
what
that.
You were trying to do. You know.
Yeah.
This
is about a year later after Preposterously Dank.
I did.
We smoked it all one with Cam, and you. Maybe you did a drop for me? Did you do like
maybe.
A
I did like
a voicemail?
Like I think I called you while I was working at Hannaford and mentioned like Roseanne or something.
So so that song we smoked.
I did come down to
Wells.
To Wells once for
to that
something.
Studio.
I don't know if I'd ended up producing anything for like that day or whatever, but yeah, no, you were and maybe you had played it for me that day or something, or brought it to me after the fact, or just sent it to me on MySpace or something and said, hey, listen to this. And it wasn't the version that ended up coming out, obviously.
No.
It was a much more demoed version, but yeah, I was like, yeah, I'm not
into this.
I'm not feeling it, man.
Well, you know what's crazy about that record? And I always say this to people, is that I knew that song. I knew something different about that song only because people I played it for, no matter what was going on. Because normally, like, you try to play people your music, and by, like, the second verse, they're, like, toned out telling you about something they did earlier in the day. And that song, everybody paid attention and everybody reacted. And it was, like, the reaction. To this day, I'd never take that out of my back pocket, but I rarely pull it out.
Yeah.
Because it's, like, I know.
Yeah.
I know I could do that again. Like, I know I could go make another song like that. And, like,
and I think that was, like, the thing that made me go, yeah, was that it was, like, you've only made one song like that. Like,
yes.
Well,
to me, it was like, no, it was for the, I definitely never envisioned it becoming this thing outside of like the people who already heard me. Like, I was like, oh, the people already know I'm dope.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
No, I made Preposterously Dank.
And
like,
maybe
no.
That's why, so I'm glad you say it that way. Cause maybe that's why it sat sort of weird with me. Cause I was like, if people that you don't,
don't
know you hear this song.
I didn't know that.
They're going to think that this is
you. And they do.
And it's
and
not.
They do to this day. I mean, even even to this day, I'm trapped in this publishing deal, right? And I had a phone call. I was supposed to do a phone call with my dude at X Publishing Company, which you could go look up if you want. big time. This dude's at the Grammys every year. You know, this is like a big time dude. And like, I was supposed to do a phone call with him, and he flaked on me this morning, 8 years later. But he still thinks I'm that.
Yeah.
You know, it's like he hasn't even heard. He hasn't heard anything. I don't know if he's ever heard anything I've done since besides Pop Song, which was about that.
Right.
Which still, I stand by, one of my better production records. But, I mean, you definitely were involved. I definitely was still bouncing songs off you and talking to you into that process of, like, promoting Preposterously Dank and into the next record. And I think...
No, but you moved, you know. Life went different ways.
Yeah, I mean, I had a kid.
Yeah.
I had a kid, and I became very... I had no free time. Any free time I had, I was scribbling fucking bars on napkins.
Yeah.
And
no, I. It seems like it was a blink of an eye between the album coming out, you having me listen to I'm Awesome, and then hearing that you got the deal. You know, like that seems like it was just a blink of an eye. Those three.
It
things,
was very
like,
quick. Well, that's why I'm not like some gigantic artist still, is because it was a blink of an eye between the first thing I ever put out and getting this big opportunity. I was so dumb. I was so naive to anything. I literally had never I didn't understand how concerts worked. Yeah. I didn't understand how record labels worked. I didn't understand that I had the leverage. Like, I signed the first deal that came to me. I was like, what? Yes. Like, $35,000? Yeah. Like, now dudes don't even sign deals for, like, under $8 million. You know, I was like, I was so naive. And, you know, I really think I've spent all the time since then kind of trying to right the ship, because what you said became reality. You know, this is what everybody's going to know you for, is just this, and that is what it became.
Yeah, but I mean, I feel like you can't beat yourself up. Oh, I'm a little bit like Spose Army, like you kidding me? Like that's
that's the thing, is I always, I make a fine living doing just rap music, and there's nobody compromising my music, and I'm very content, and I got like diehard fans, and I can go on tour, everything's good. But the people who knew this album, this first album, Preposterously Dank, and then heard that song, most of them are still with me.
Yeah.
Because they knew.
Yeah.
They knew that was just a slice of the pie, you know, and ever since then, I'm like, even my next record, you know, I just played a couple new songs I've been making for somebody, and they were like, whoa, they're like, it's like you, this is a Radiohead, man. I don't know if you listen to Radiohead at all, but like it's like you skipped OK Computer and went right to Kid A, which is like OK Computer is the big giant like towering rock album, and then Kid A sounds like it imploded in on itself and like a dead like alien rose out of it, and then it's almost like Dark Twisted Fantasy to Yeezus, the Kanye albums.
Gotcha, I can follow that. Yeah.
And so I was like, okay, we'll see how this goes. You know, I guess I should have made OK Computer first, but definitely my life since Preposterously Dank has been very guided by the I'm Awesome experience.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. It's been, I think one of the, and this is maybe completely off topic, but like one of the things that sort of blew me away after Preposterously Dank and really kept me super interested at that point, you know, because I'm trying to, you know, we're separated, but
homies for life because we were part of something.
I noticed you started to, and I still love it to this day. And nobody else does this, at least around here, as far as I can hear. But it's the live instrumentation that goes into all the songs, like that. And that started
on the first album.
Yeah, yeah. Even
I can pinpoint every individual place where there was live instrumentation on that album. There's a guitar solo on "That's That," which was Chris Quint, and it's two layers of guitar, and then it's Chris Quint playing the instruments on "To the Head," playing the guitar. And it really was just, I was so limited at the time with understanding how to record instrumentation. And now that's when I did the album in a day, that's kind of to show you the full circle of like, I'm a producer,
yeah.
You know, is really what I am.
And that's what got, but that's what made it really easy with a lot of songs to just like hand them to people and say like, oh, just listen to this. Cause there was a lot of like, for people that maybe weren't super into like rap.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, well,
I'm combating that anyways. Yeah, in my everyday thing is like, the audience for white rap music from Maine is pretty small. So I need to expand the potential audience, you know? And so, you know, after we get off this, I'll show you what the new record starts like, and you'll be like, whoa, okay. Like that's, you know, okay. That's crazy. But thank you. But that comes from Preposterously Dank. That's where I was into.
Yeah.
You know, I was a guitarist in a band.
It just makes for such. I mean, I don't know. Everybody has their own preference, but I love like live instrumentation in hip hop. Like it's amazing.
Well, all the greats kind of have always done that, anyways. Yeah. Outkast albums are live instrumentation for the most part. Yeah. You know, there's like something, but that's Organized Noise playing most of that.
And it seems to be like for the I don't know, the type of music scene that Portland has, it seems to probably attract a little bit more, you know, like it's, people would love to show up to a show with drums and a guitar as opposed to just like, hey, I've got to, you know, slap my laptop in and I a mic and see how it goes, you know.
Which sometimes I think, damn, I make a lot more money that way. Paying musicians is expensive. But no, I mean, for me, I am super fortunate to have broke through to, you know, almost every person I ever wanted to in Maine, except Lady Lamb the Beekeeper, who still won't fuck with me. She's very nice to me, but she won't do a song with me, which I respect and I love her. But I'm going to be persistent and someday she will. I promise. But, you know, I've been fortunate enough to break through that, like, now it's not like my brother's roommate playing guitar, even though Chris Quinn is a great guitarist. It's like, I could go find the best guitarist in the state of Maine and they're going to play on here. And I will say, I think I do provide an opportunity for some, you know, because there's a lot of musicians who are super talented but have no direction as to, like, how do you apply that to pop music, popular music? Like, how do you do that? And I've been able to present that opportunity to a lot of dudes and females and also just had an opportunity to work with people who really have understood that long before me, such as, like, Dave Gutter, you know, or the dudes in Rustic Overtones. Or
it's been cool, too, to see the people that you bring in that I've never even heard of before. Like, when I listen to Humans, I'm like, I don't know. I know, like, two of these people.
Well, KG Freeze, for example, who's all, he's singing that, like, you better run for your life on Humans. It was like, I just know, it's almost like, I equated it to, like, colors. Like, you have all the colors to paint with. I was like, all right, on this song, I need a little KG Freeze right here. Okay. You know, and it's like, I know what I, and it's not only, like, what that color does. It's like, okay, what do I want that color to do?
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I want you to say, you better run for your life. And he nailed it. You know, it's like, just knowing people, it's almost like a coach being like, okay, this dude's great at running, like, these type of routes, or, like, this guy, I don't know the, you know, the football terminology exactly,
right,
but, like,
right,
this guy, you know, this guy is a good blocker, you know, on the, he can fake, you know, this quarterback could actually be a receiver, you know, is like, things like that is kind of the way I look at it now. And I have a very clear, I think of Spose, the brand, any differently now than I do when we did Preposterously Dank, as far as, like, I know what a Spose song is. I just think I have more resources now.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome. I mean, what else could you ask for?
Yeah, really? That's the best. I mean, that's the fucking
best. I'm
still
basically the same, except I could do everything I want to do.
Yeah, I mean, and I will say, I think my wife might play a big part in that, because I met her. I had no success that wasn't grounded by her being like, put away the dish, you know, or like whatever. So it's like, it was never, I never became this, like, flippant, like, basically like the super arrogant douchebag I would have ended up as if I had never met her.
I think I got, like, a text message shortly after you got that deal.
Yeah.
That was like, don't let him fuck. Like, don't
from
let
her.
This, yeah. Like,
oh,
don't
wow.
let this, like, don't let him become retarded.
Yeah, she's always looked out for me, I think, for her sake, you know, because who knows what type of idiot I could have became, you know. And I think everybody did a pretty good job reining me in, you know, and keeping me definitely some, you know. But I think any times I had trouble with it, I realize now it's like, I got to put that in song, because it's like the thing about that first album is I was telling a lot of, like, secrets because I had nothing to lose and I was young and reckless. And I think I kind of got away from it and got a little guarded. And the 444 Jay-Z album has kind of, like, showed me that, like, oh, you kind of just got to tell them some secrets,
because
that's, like, the timeless shit is the... There's an interview with No ID where he said that.
Yeah, and I'm sure nothing bad ever came from over divulging in a track, right?
No, I don't.
Which
think
is
so.
Something I always kind of wondered about, like, how much can you actually say? Like, when you're thinking about, like, okay, here I am in my basement, no one's gonna hear this shit, versus, like, this is gonna be on the radio, this is gonna be on iTunes. Like, who do I need to know that I was doing this thing that I shouldn't have been doing? You know.
Well, I certainly have made songs I never put out, because of that, or things I changed drastically, but. I think when I made this album, I was like, all right, I did it. You know, I was like, I did it. That's probably all I'm ever going to have. You know, it's like, I had put my heart and soul, like, my everything into this record. I was like, that's pretty much it. Yeah. I figured, you know. And then even the next project, I was like, all right, well, that's that, you know? And I somewhere along the way, I realized, like, there's never a day I'm not making a song. Yeah. So maybe this is just a forever thing.
Yeah.
Whoops. You know, almost like, oh, I didn't envision that. And now I realize I'm like a chronic, it's almost like you have to piss. Like, I gotta get something out.
It's crazy for me to think how many years have gone by.
And 10.
And your days are still, because my days aren't filled with writing songs. My days are filled with spreadsheets and like code for random things and trying to piece together all this. Like,
but you're just like such a renaissance man. Man, no, it's kind of wild to see you
confined
to one of your skills.
No, career confused career-wise perpetually. But no, it's crazy to see. Anytime anybody is able to spend like a lifetime isn't quite the right word, but like decade or more on the same thing, especially something you love, man. Like, and that's kind of like what my point always was, not always was, but was earlier. Like, you know, if you can do what makes you happy and you can figure out how to get the people to show up to the shows and you can figure out how to pay all the people on time and you can figure out exactly how much to charge for this to keep people coming and not go broke and make like, then, and you're like, that just warms my heart like crazy to see. I mean, it's been,
Thank
I haven't
you,
seen
man.
You in years, man.
I know.
You know what I mean?
I know.
And here you are.
Last time
you
saw you.
You got more tattoos than I,
yeah,
you know, it's
I,
like,
I had no, I think when we did Preposterously Dank, I had two tattoos. One of them is a Spose tattoo on my like abs, which are not abs. And then I had the tattoo on my shoulder that said live now.
Yeah.
As in like, do cocaine.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, you know, it was that mindset. And last time I saw you, and maybe I'm wrong, I remember the last two times I saw you, I brought you the book, the Spose Complete Lyrics, Almost Complete Lyrics book, which I dedicated to you and Eric Doms for Get Me Started. And I saw you at the, what the fuck is that festival called up in Yarmouth Clam Festival.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Because I think you had just biked some sort of.
Oh, was I racing?
You had just
I was
raced.
Probably racing.
Yeah,
because
you
yeah.
have a.
Yeah, race bikes.
You
yeah.
race bikes.
Yeah.
bicycles.
Yeah, yeah.
And I saw you and I met your son,
yeah,
which was awesome for me because I'd never met him. And I think I was there. I think we might only had two kids
at
the time.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, you guys had just bought like a...
Oh, no, we had like four. I just bought a huge painting of a raccoon on a skateboard.
Yeah.
It's still in my office. I have so much dope art. Like, nobody ever gets to see it. But someday when I like achieve my multi-billion-dollar dream, I will have a large art collection in my house. And the raccoon on the skateboard is like the crown jewel of my collection.
It seemed pretty frivolous, but, you know,
yeah.
you do
No,
what you
I
do.
Mean, all that art is like completely frivolous because it does nothing. It just sits on the wall. There's actually, you said you might be moving to the Ville. There's this kid in Waterville, Ryan Kohler, who did the Humans cover. He painted that. And he just did the cover. I don't want to, never mind, I won't say that. But he's done some great art. And I buy it off him like for, I don't know, $200 or something. And I just am so confident that this kid's art's going to be worth so much someday that I'm like, yeah, $250, deal. I'm like, who's going to pay for my kids?
Yeah.
Like,
there's a college fund there.
Okay, so let's just run through the track list real quick and you give me some thoughts on these records if anything comes to mind. Preposterously Dank, the first song on the album.
Bill slept on me, I never wake up early, but I stuff white owls, call it taxidermy.
Great opening song, man. I think it did exactly what we were trying to do as far as like open up an album. You know what I mean? A little bit of...
Shout out to Eric Doms who produced that idea.
Yeah, it was definitely not like a straight through song, which I liked for a first song, you know?
Bars. It was just bars, and it had that sample from Weeds.
Yeah.
This TV show, hopefully they don't sue me.
Still. I love dropping those little gems in there.
And I do remember that song, I will say, as like I looked at it as like this is what I stand for. Sweatpants, fanny packs, bought that at TJ Maxx, Spose turned ganja black, just bought a 20 sack, but also like I remember making I forget the lyrics, but it's like something disappears, like female babies in Japan or China, you know? And it was like, just to say like my whole point. And I remember, I think this was like the only reason my wife fucked with me, like out the gate, was she was like, it seems like you know about world politics. And I was like, yes, I know very
Hold
much.
On, I need to Google that. I need to Google that real quick.
But I mean, that we'll get into that and that's that. But yeah, I think that definitely set the tone. Track two, Fuck It.
Alrighty, we got wealth disproportionate. Teen suicide, no need for Kevorkian. Dope people mixed with should have been abortion kids. Wells Maine from the casket to the orphanage and back again.
If you own me.
Another Eric Doms production. Obviously, that's a sample. Again, don't sue me. That actually came. I actually rapped that, and I can play a little portion of it right here.
Yeah. Could you?
Oh, the song. Okay. I was gonna say I'm gonna put. Well, I actually recorded this initially over Lil Kim's "Crush on You."
I did not know. All right.
All yeah. Right. So I have that somewhere, and I can. I think you mixed it, or maybe Doms mixed it. I don't know, but I had a mixed version. It was Doms of me rapping over those. All those verses for Fuck It came from this, like, just verses I did, like, mixtape style over Crush on You by Lil Kim.
White dude Nikes, suburban living with the blunts, half pipes beat. Quite abundant nightlife, unlively. Glove compartment got Febreze and Visine. VCR, TV combo, not widescreen. Mike V, hustle trees unidly. 12-year-olds fake IDs and rich dads keep their yards tidy. Yo, shall I proceed? Alrighty, we got wealth disproportionate. Teen suicide, no need for Kevorkian.
That song, I don't actually even have this album on my laptop, so I can't play it for you, but
I wanted to listen to it in the car on the way down. My kid fell asleep.
Maybe I'll do it. Yeah.
It's
yeah,
like, oh man.
Headphone. The, and then, okay. Fuck It also is like a big record, you know, for like that album. That was like the song that I think was like the big song for a lot of people.
Yeah. And it definitely was one of the ones that came out the cleanest, I think.
Yeah, definitely sounded the most almost like professional. Even when I signed a record deal, they wanted me to. They said that was like the second single. They were gonna go clear the sample, and they they made a version with like a synth bass line in it. Ugh. They were like, "Oh, this is the one," you know. Monty Lipman told me that. If you want to look him up on Wikipedia. Third track is John Madden.
John Madden, Cam Groves.
Cam Groves' debut.
Doesn't matter what the numbers even show on the price. I'm always taking chances like I'm rolling the dice. And I used to push the ganja from an O to a slice. But
yeah.
Still a legendary verse. Shout out to Mike George, who, I mean, if people don't know, that whole first verse is a play on Somebody Gotta Die by Biggie, which is one of my favorite songs. Easily one of my favorite storytelling songs, but Eric Doms produced that, and then we recorded that, like we said, at your girl's house. Any memories of John Madden?
I remember. I mean, I remember Cam came over to the Winter Street place. Yeah. We recorded that there.
He was so nervous.
He was. I do. That's so weird to me that he was nervous.
I know.
Because for me, I'm like, you're here with like one of your good friends, man. Like, you guys do this all the time, right? Like, and now I'm fine. Yeah.
It was a big thing. You know, I think it's a big thing. I mean, I remember my first time going up with Braden Biddings to record, who I also met through mainhiphop.com to record Neptune's production, which was like my first studio song. And I remember just being so nervous because I was like, oh my God, this is real. I better not fuck it up. It's not like me hitting record on acid.
Meanwhile, like, I'm worried that I'm going to like not hit record or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, I'm totally going to fuck this up.
Yeah. I loved going up there to record for me because for some reason it just like made it more serious. It's like I took these songs serious, more serious than like me making a freestyle with my buddies on my computer, you know? Yeah. Okay. Next, Drugs, Girls, Money, Liquor.
So I'm drunk, trying to find shrooms, and the slam pig starting to look like Heidi Klum. Oh yeah.
And my thoughts. So, yeah.
What's your thoughts?
Well, it's just funny to me because that one song, the one thing that sticks with me with that song is that it's the same sample, right? As
I Love College by Asher Roth.
Yes. Yes. So it just brings me instantly back to like. It's not fair, man.
Yeah, you know, I mean,
it's not fair, man.
I mean, when I heard Asher Roth.
I swear to God, he recorded this song way before Asher Roth recorded this song or put it out.
It's way better lyrics than the Asher Roth song. I really, you know, not, and I don't want to take anything away from anybody, and I can't, but I definitely had a strong feeling that I beat everybody to this shit.
Yeah.
With this album. Yeah. And it's etched in time. Like, you can look at the times of when things happened, and you can trace everything. And that's not to say they stole these things from me. And maybe a bunch of people were... maybe a bunch of people were on this same collision course with like this new style of rap where you can be yourself.
I just remember hearing, because I don't remember when. I remember Asher Roth sort of blew up, and I heard the Sleep in the Bread Aisle mixtape or whatever that's on. And I just remember thinking, like, has Ryan heard this?
I remember where I was when I heard him.
How did this, wait, and I'm looking at the date on the release, and I'm like, this doesn't make any, this is the same.
This is not the
to anybody that's ever heard a sample used more than one way. This is clearly the same fucking sample. Like, what happened here? I was so confused. I thought I was going to get a text from you that was like, oh man, we're suing so-and-so for.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's a Weezer sample, and I made that beat. You know what's crazy is the album came out 10 years ago, but I actually made that beat and that song in 2005.
Oh, wow.
This was like right out. I remember it was the summer right when I got out of college. I was at my mom's house and I had written that joint, and I actually wrote this other joint called It's All Right With Me, which didn't end up on the album, but definitely could have. Is maybe better than a lot of the songs on the album. And I'm actually going to throw a bunch of records at the end of the podcast that didn't make it onto the album, so you can hear some of the other loose ends.
I remember that song vividly. Did that land on anything else?
It's actually, if you go look up Preposterously Dank right now on any streaming service, the album, that's like the bonus track.
Oh, okay.
Next track is the Poetic Genius Gobble a Dank.
We need more beats.
Every time Spose in a beat coalesce, it is no less than sick, nasty, grotesque.
Do you remember this?
I remember, if that's the same, I mean, I know the song, but a small bit of unease, because I feel like we had different
two parts of the beat.
Yeah. Because
the beat changes.
But also different. I think we recorded vocals like in two different places, so they sound totally different.
And you did your best to kind of rein it in. I don't know if anybody notices that, but like definitely I remember we were worried that, like, because I think we made the beat and then we lost the stems. So we only had like that one bounce of like the beat. And you did your best with it, and
but also that was like one of the times where I remember like I was helping out as much as I could, but I still had no idea what I was doing, because like I couldn't make vocals that were recorded in one room like sound the same as vocals that were recorded in like a different house or whatever.
Yes,
I was like, oh, should I suck at this?
Well, no, that's not easy. I mean, even John Wyman was just saying to me the other day, he's like, because I was over at the Halo and we were mixing a record, and I had punched in like two bars in their soundproof, beautiful room on their perfect mic into their setup, and then the rest of it's recorded with the air conditioner running and the Sanford police, you know, in the background. And he's like, yeah, I had to. I was like, all right, sorry, man. Gobble a Dank. I remember making that beat with Eric Doms, using his like keyboard at his house in Alston. And then I remember like it got like late, like 10 o'clock. And I was like, all right, man, could you drive me home? Like, I didn't have a car. And he was like, no, I don't really want to drive you home. And I was like, shit. So I had to go find like the T and like get a train back. Under Control tracks.
We gotta keep them under control. You know, we get down, we live now, cause we're free to do what we want, and we rep the ME. Wells Payne got mad blunts to roll. We gotta keep them under control. And though I'm a proponent of boning and smoking tonic, I propose doing both at discretion. I've learned lessons. It's unimpressive, but my checks bounce like asses, blunt ashes all over the sofa and the mirror.
It's like I love it. Love it.
It's Cam Grove's favorite song too. Go ahead.
Yeah, I love the chance to do a little talk box thing. Like I ran out to like, I don't know, Goodwill or something, right? To find like the cheapest amp I could find, right? So I spent like $10 on this like crappy. I mean, I don't know if you even recognize it was like a green, like,
I don't know the amp, but I remember you doing it with the mouthpiece.
So playing, like, you know, go to the internet to figure out how to look up to build a talk box, and it's just like a guitar amp with a tubed, like a
going into like a quarter inch,
basically
jack?
Going into the the oh man, I'm
the
gonna
amp
forget.
In the back. Or the...
You, I'm pretty sure it goes like right into the cone, like the speaker cone.
Oh, okay.
So you and you hook the actual amp up to like the keyboard. So you actually play like through the amp, but then you use your mouth to
choose
kind of like
what
modulate the,
yeah,
the sound.
Yeah. I just did some vocoder the other day,
similar
which is just
sound.
Playing through
yeah.
a microphone, but not at all the talkbox.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I just remember being so like elated that you did that because I was like, oh, this elevates the album to a whole nother level. And that beat, that song also was almost like, oh, this is like just even on an album of full on like weed, sex, you know, like all this chaos to say you got to keep it under control. Yeah. I felt a little mature about that. Right
and it now. Also like the, I love the way the intro was like, just it's slow. The song itself doesn't start up for a while.
Build.
You know, like you don't hear that in rap. And this was a, you know, a reminder. This is a kid. This is a kid's album who's trying to like make it as a rapper. Like I'm going to put a 30-second build in here with some instrumentation. Like it just wasn't, I just loved it. It was great.
Thank you.
It's great.
I still try to take risks like that to this day because I do feel like any limitations of hip hop are invented.
Yeah.
You know, it's like we're like, oh, that was what that album sounded like, so you gotta sound like that. Speaking of minute long intros, the next song is Goddamn.
It's got me scheming on a master plan. So yo, I rolled into court when rooster o'clock in two different socks. Mad bitches with speeding tickets was kicking it. The courtroom is crickets.
Damn, that's one with some revealing stuff on it, right?
Yeah, it's the one where I basically got arrested as a freshman in college and went to jail. It's a true story.
I think that was one of my more like favorite songs that I wished had been popular, like more popular initially, maybe. But I mean, I'm pretty sure that's a song that ends up on the playlist more often than not.
Yeah,
right?
Most people. I mean, that was the. I will say that was the first time that song. This is the only song anybody's ever come up to me at that point. Anybody had ever come up to me after a show and been like, hey, yeah, I've been going through something like, and that song was like, oh, it made me feel like, oh, I'm not alone. And I'm like, oh, what? Yeah. I was like, are you, wait, what? Cause I didn't know. I didn't understand. I remember it was at the Bull Moose in Sanford. I did it in store.
I think I was there for that.
It was like April. I remember it was like April 19th after I had put out.
Was this the one where the guy offered you like the deal? There was a guy like there and he was like, I will pay you right now for something.
Oh man, I don't remember
anyway,
that.
Anyway,
maybe
anyway.
It was weird. It was a lot of firsts. It was like chicks I knew came to the show and like a couple friends and like some kid I'd never met before is telling me that goddamn. Helped him through something, and that's when I realized, like, whoa, this is not just about me proving I'm the man. This is like maybe there's some sort of power in this beyond music. And still to this day, I'm shocked by like the effective. For example, the song "Knocking on Wood" of mine is very. I get a message about that every fucking. You know, if I ever need like an ego boost, I'll just go scroll through my Facebook messages. It's like 9 you save my lives, and then 1, or there's like 8 will you save my lives, 1 will you play my 4-year-old's birthday party, and 1 fuck you, man, an AR-15 is actually, you know, it's like, I'm like, okay, bro. And then, so the next song you produced, Jim Brown produced, Just an MC 2.
No fancy restaurant, $20 entrees. It is Wendy's, it is Friendly's, it is empty, it is cake. No Tyrone, Bigum's crack rocks for my pot at. A movie director, man, I don't get shot at. Unburly rhyme satirist and Hurley and Atticus. Never up early counting cash on my abacus.
Yep, and that was, we pieced that together a little bit after the fact, right?
I want to say I was like, maybe that and Under Control were the last pieces of the album.
Yep.
I remember the final version of that was going on the album, and I was like, I had barely even heard it.
Yeah.
You know, it was like we were just getting close to the end.
Yeah.
And
that was definitely recorded originally over a totally different beat.
Maybe I have if I can find it, I'll throw it on the
album.
Yeah,
I would love to hear the OG. Whatever the original beat was. Yeah, because that's one of the few, if I'm being honest. I'm like, oh, fuck, man.
Yeah.
I had other beats.
Yeah. In retrospect, the version ended up on there, I think that one ended up being. You know, that's kind of like my statement of purpose in a way. And what are those samples in there? It's like Cartoon Network something. I forget what's in there. It's like some vocal samples. Either way, the next song, To the Head, either opens or closes with a voicemail from Mike V, angry and drunk that I had not called him back. Fuck opens. You, Spose, yeah. you yeah. fucking ass.
Play this message. Press 4 to get envelope information about this message.
Dude, I fucking can, dude. I got a ball. So fuck you, Spose, dude. What the fuck, dude? I'm gonna fucking fuck you in here. Dude, fucking Justin Tickham. I'm gonna fucking bring his fucking ass too, right along with all you motherfuckers.
End of message. To delete this message, press 7. To save it in the archives, press 9. To
It is he who drew verses, shows no mercy. Blazed, always looking like I just ate turkey. In my life, no red dots, neither guns nor herpes. And the bong water's murky. I'll be perched at my mom's, breaking up some merch, smelling like a marsh. Just got out of work.
And so we included several voicemails on that album, which became kind of like the unintentionally like cohesive part of the album. There's even another one about like Harry Potter, maybe, with Mike George that we recorded at your house that day.
No, that's I will remember for being like done when you gave it to me. Like,
yeah, that's that.
Recorded a song. You want to listen to it? I was like, that song's done.
To the Head or That's That? Both of them, probably. I think I had finished both.
Yeah, I'm thinking To the Head.
Okay, yeah. So
That's That. No,
To the Head. Still to this day, maybe one of my favorite things I've ever done. For the sake that A, it sounds like nothing else, and then B, I felt lyrically it was like my peak as far as like, not now, I don't think that, but like every bar, and I ripped the Backwoods emblem as the blunt sesh assembling in the summer bare arms like the Second Amendment. You could find me just hanging like an ornament, snorting jagged little pills, call him Alanis Morissette. I was like, fuck every rapper. That's the best bars I've ever heard. It was like where I was at the time, you know? I remember writing that when I was living at my friend Melanie's on her couch, on her futon, and she went away to Australia for a semester and I got to use her room and I recorded that, and Chris Quint was playing guitar on that. And next song is That's That.
Suicide vans in Bethlehem, no Christmas caroling. I blame nobody but American arrogance. I mean, shit, we created the damn terrorists. Opening up the fridge on MTV Cribs as miserable kids starve with visible ribs.
It was like the kind of political song on the album, but it was important for me to include that because it kind of just wanted to show I wasn't just partying.
Yeah.
That one might have came to you kind of done because me and Eric Doms produced that.
Yeah, I think it did. I think it did, but definitely not the same. It didn't hit me the same way that To the Head did.
To the Head, yeah.
Like
yeah.
That was still like,
That's That is okay. It's like the seed of like something bigger that I never really fleshed out in my career and probably should have.
No, that was, like I said earlier, that was like more of the surprise that so much of the stuff that Eric was doing was coming out so good. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you guys were who I knew, you know, it was like, I made a couple beats on here, but I didn't think of myself as a producer at the time, even though I realize now I produced 50 beats before then, you know, I was making tons of music. The last track on the album is another one of my favorite things I've ever done. It's the outro, and you produce this too.
Never made supper, Alex, what is dessert? But what bird could front on a free birch to perch as he learns to live life and adulthood lurks? And that's mediocrity knocking because I'm hardly Tupac and I do too much talking. And he's rocking mics as doubters are mocking him because they say he burns trees like he hates oxygen. But dag nabbit, despite my bad habits, you can find me next to Springsteen in your iPod gadget. I still got a bad taste in my palate, cause I wonder, life, are you gonna go my way like Lenny Kravitz?
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah,
I remember you sending it to me and me being like, oh, this is, cause you know what it was Jay-Z's Kingdom Come, the album had just come out, like his comeback album.
Yeah,
because he retired. Yeah. Black album happened, shout out to the Black album, one of the greatest albums of all time. And he retires and he comes back with Kingdom Come, and a lot of Kingdom Come is like whatever, you know, dig a hole's dope, and then like 30's the new 20 or whatever is cool. And Lost Ones is cool, but like Show Me What You Got sucks, even though the beat is dope by Just Blaze. But the best song on Kingdom Come is the prelude, the first song. And it literally is, it sounds almost like if you go listen to the prelude by Jay-Z and you listen to the outro by Spose on Preposterously Dank, very similar vibes. Yeah. And that was what I was trying to channel, was that was the way Jay-Z like blacks out on that. And like, the game's fucked up and their beats are banging, man, their hooks did it, you know, or whatever. And I was like, oh, let me just say, you know, it was really what I was going for on that one. Do you remember anything about that one?
Oh man, I got to listen to that one again, because I almost don't even believe you when you tell me I produced it.
You did, man. It's an iconic joint. A lot of people like that one. There's a secret track on Preposterously Dank, which is no longer a secret, but it was the acoustic version of Drugs, Girls, Money, Liquor, which I played at Small World one night. Yes,
yeah.
And I think you recorded it. Oh, and I'm, dude. What?
It's just bringing me back.
Yeah, man. It's crazy. It was crazy. It was so cool, man. It was wild when you had that Small World. And I remember you closed it shortly after the album came out. And I just remember being like, all right, what do I do now? Because that's what I was going to do. I think we smoked it all. I intended to take it up there and do it with you. And I ended up, they opened a music store in Wells. And attached to it, they had a recording studio with an engineer, which I have that all in quotes.
Yeah.
And but that's where we ended up doing. We smoked it all and did I'm Awesome and Sexy John Madden. And
yeah, no, we finished that album, and then there was no reason to have that space anymore. You know, it's like who knew what the next thing would be. And I mean, I felt pretty confident that like wherever you took it, like you would have whatever.
Yeah,
I shouldn't say you would have whatever. You'd have better resources. You know what
or
I mean?
Well, I'd find some way to achieve goal.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
All right. Any overarching thoughts before we leave? I think that's like the podcast, by the way, fly fucking by. It's been like an hour. Isn't that crazy?
Really. I mean, thanks for having me. It's a crazy blast from the past. I can't tell you how many times people are like, how weird it is and how often it happens when people are like I'll get it, like I'm at work, right? So I get it and you text me I'm at work, right? And you're like, is this still your number? And I'm like,
oh yeah. When I appreciated that you had a phone, you have one of those phones where I can see if you're typing.
Oh yeah.
Like people who don't have that stress me out, because it's like, wait, what? Like, are you here?
See,
you're not
the opposite. I don't. That just adds anxiety for me, because I see somebody typing and I'm like,
oh, and then they don't. Well, I saw you typing right away, and I was like, okay, so somebody has this number.
But yeah, it's crazy. These reminders that I get that like there was this. Because to me, it feels like four lifetimes ago. Like, I've switched jobs and things so many times, and it's like, you know, you text me, and I'm like, yeah, it's still my number. I stand up at my desk, and I'm laughing or whatever, and, the, you know, it's people, like, wow, what's so funny? I'm like, when I tell you
like,
what I'm doing right now, you're going to be like, wait,
oh,
what?
God.
You know, and then I have to get into the
story.
You know, it's like, wow, how did you, what, when, in your, it's, yeah, yep.
Do you
like
leave my, out that you're a rapper?
Usually, yeah. I mean, I just say, you know, I helped him with that album, you know, it's, I, that's, because that's what I did, you know. I didn't,
you did, man. I'm super thankful, and I always try to, any chance I get, to just give you guys your props, because without you and Eric, I don't know that college me pursues this, and I was ready to work at a newspaper. Like, yeah. I was, even after I dropped this album, I still didn't think it was going to pop off. Like, I dropped it and I was getting a little extra money, maybe like $300 extra.
Yeah.
You know, to like, I was like, all right, well, let me print some t-shirts. Mm-hmm. But someone pointed out to me that they're like, that's it. They're like, that's the secret of you, is that you got $300 extra and you bought t-shirts. Yeah. And I was like, oh, okay, maybe that's it. Maybe that is it. But my thought was, well, maybe I could get $700, you know, like if I sell all the t-shirts.
Yeah.
And
no, it makes me super happy to see you thriving. And I'll never forget thinking to myself, man, if this guy could just, I hope he keeps, you know, a level head. Seems to be, you make most, you know, like, yeah, you might smoke a joint on the way to the show, but like, you're going to be at the show.
I'm definitely
You're going to be at the show, and it's going to be a good show, you know. And
one thing, maybe part of that too, is like the stereotypes of hip hop is like one of my main things I'm trying to combat all the time. And one of the biggest things, if you know, if anybody's ever been to a Spose show in the last couple of years, I'm starting earlier than you expect, giving you a better show than you expect, with no bullshit and no fucked up, like, you know, Hopefully, you know. I mean, I've definitely slipped up a few, especially in that early period. I want to say especially after I'm Awesome, I was like drunk. You know, it was like I shouldn't have. I was too young. You know, I was too young and too dumb. It's like if I had the opportunity now, it's like I understand it now. It's like, okay, this is not the moment you get drunk. This is the this is the test. You know, this is not like the after the graduation party. This is like the test.
Yeah. Well, you passed the test, man. It's crazy.
Man.
There's people I see, people like people I went to school with that are like, you know, Megan, right?
Megan Pettit?
No. Well, yeah, Megan Pettit. Yeah,
yeah.
She's a belt too. No, she's no. That's a blast from the past in itself. But yeah, no. Garland goes to your shows. Dutchie.
Oh, Megan Dutchie Garland.
Yeah. So like I went to school, well, I was a couple years ahead of her, but went to school with like her older sister. And so like, that's kind of cool. Like to see how that.
Shout out to Megan. Who's a diehard.
Yeah. Like seeing her, like it was, cause like she's on my friends list, right?
Mm.
On Facebook. Right. And to see that she, I feel like I can remember when she started listening and she was like, oh, this dude's awesome. I'm like, oh, I know. It's good. Yeah, and then now she's like, you know, going to all your shows,
and
doing whatever
over
she does to
England.
You know, it's like, it's just crazy to see.
Yeah, she's one of those fans that's like so extreme that like the wall of fanhood is like gone in a way. Like I know what she does, I know where she works, I know stuff about her family, and super thankful for them, the diehards. And it's actually almost like a challenge to like keep them excited. Yeah. By making sure everything's a surprise, because like if they know something's coming, it's very important that like your biggest fan's reaction is still elation when you do something, rather than like, oh, knew this was coming, this is great, you know. Yeah, man, it's got to be wild, I guess, to see like, but it's like it's almost like this like dirty secret of yours, you know, that you did this album, you know, that you like stashed it in your past. And I'm happy to bring it out of the closet.
I'm glad you did, man. It was like, get that text message and it's been 10 years. It's like bullshit.
No, isn't that crazy?
No, it hasn't. Shit. I got to accomplish something before I talk to him. I don't know.
Dude, you do like bike marathons. Like I haven't done any shit like that. Dude, thank you so much, man. I really appreciate you making the time and again for pushing me to finish this and being a part of, you know, one of the biggest moments of my life, this album. So
thanks for having me. Thanks for doing what you do, man. We love it.
Thanks, man. All right. I'd tell you to go look up Jim Brown everywhere, but he's incognito. You can't find him. Just give him love if you see him out on a bike somewhere. See him out with his kid, dap him up, give him the Fight Club head nod. All right, man. And we're gonna get into, I'm gonna play a bunch of stuff. I'll actually figure it out after Matt leaves, but I'm gonna pick a bunch of songs that didn't make the album and maybe demo versions or whatever. We'll throw them at the end here as like an anthology. And happy 10 years, Preposterously Dank, man.
Put them up, y'all. Yes, y'all. Oh shit. In the basement with your kids. Bring it. Since we were children, I've been chilling in an ill little village with a deer outnumber the pigs. Oh, Wells, Maine. Lawns freshly cut, litter picked up, nobody's laid dead in the streets. It appears so pure, serene in brochures, evergreens in a sandy beach. But behind that veil are darker details, an underworld most fail to see. Allow me. Maine's mundane like C-SPAN, even on the weekends. Still, it's got a story to tell. It's not Seventh Heaven, my brethren. It's called Wells, and it's where all the heathens dwell. Follow me. I got a gaggle of friends who got bags of weed that all seem to disappear magically. Girlfriends turned into casualties by abusive dudes, suburban tragedy. As boredom transforms to agony, the townsfolk do coke and smoke avidly. Trees and blow with dro to Mike V. Get blunts in your mouth like cavities. Heart so empty, life so swell. Restaurants, hotels, get high, drive to Wendy's. Town so friendly, but there's nothing going on, and the devil's so tempting.
Saints in the basement with your kids. Bring an Ellen to the place you live. He won't leave once he gets in, so light something up, mess him. Satan's in the basement with your kids. Bringing hell into the place you live, and he won't leave once he gets in. So light something up and pass to him.
A lot of, if not all, your sons and daughters got the marijuana, sex and rock and roll is right up under your nose.
What I'm saying is,
devil crept in, slept in my mom's bed. I recall that his pigment was Marlboro red. veins pulsated when he got aggravated. I hated him since she started dating him, but whatever. Used to want to lace his weed with radium or stab him when he smacked her while I was watching Aladdin come home from school. Mom's on the porch, crying out her eyes while the devil's in the door. When the weed is gone, we comb rugs and sofas for tiny crumbs. On these occasions, stoner zombies spring to life like rescue workers searching rubble for survivors. Not only are cushions lifted, but couches are moved to inspect the dust beneath them. Grimy bathrooms are frisked and heavy stationary furniture becomes movable. During these times, anything is possible. Every pothead knows that clumsy bowl packers spill little green treasures in unlikely crevices. The results of these searches may vary. On the most fruitful hunts, entire bags, or at least sizable nuggets, have been triumphantly found in the back seats of Dodges and Jeeps. These are glorious times, celebrated predictably with blunt and bong rips. Sometimes, however, all the crevices are harvested and the unthinkable becomes true. There is no weed. During these grim circumstances, we smoke resin. Like a fallback friend, called only when all your other friends are unavailable, resin is always there and is always willing to help out. Even when a beloved pipe breaks, and usually a stoner heart along with it, resin is there, caked onto every shard, waiting to be scraped and smoked in mourning. It takes a little longer to light and tastes ashy, but resin is dependable. When drug deals fall through, paychecks run out, resin gives us a sticky, black shoulder to cry on.
I can hear that shit. Bimpin'? Is it bimpin'? I believe it's bimpin'. I'll make it rain. I'm put down this bus slightly.
White dude Nikes, suburban living with the blunts, half pipes beat. Quite abundant nightlife, unlively. Glove compartment got Febreze and Visine. VCR, TV combo, not widescreen. Mike V, hustle trees unidly. 12-year-olds fake IDs and rich dads keep their yards tidy. Yo, shall I proceed? Alrighty, we got wealth disproportionate. Teen suicide, no need for Kevorkian. Dope people mixed with should have been abortioned kids. Wells Maine from the casket to the orphanage. And back again, I'm from the place where the wives scream. Redneck fists aren't soft like ice cream. Police lights shine bright white every night like Jesus Christ light beams. And the radio sucks, so turn up the outcast. I know you hate what's on the radio.
True.
Yeah, fuck what's on the radio.
True.
but I know you still pay it some attention. Listening to Nickelback and Evanescence, that Laffy Taffy lean with it, skeet skeet. Another lame single every day of the week. Fuck radio for what it does and doesn't do. And if you like that shit, then fuck you too. And I've been dope with these rants since everybody rocked them JNCO pants. And Justin, JC, and Lance used to blare at every junior high dance while my mom was in the basement watering plants with the xenon lights. Rural life ain't polite. Welcome to the jungle, stash the weed by the grundle. My buddy mumbled that the cop probably knows his uncle. Get it dropped like a fumble. I said that shit's bimping. 5'8", eyes dilate when I'm baked. Guidos and tuxedos buy steaks at high rates. For Christ's sake, American parents are irate, cause they seen their daughters gyrate all on MySpace. On the couch, passed out being an ass clown. But they say that Spose kid is dope with his mouth. He's the illest illicist in social studies syllabus before Islamic militants were killing us. Spose, I know you hate what's on the radio.
True.
Yeah, fuck what's on the radio.
True.
But I know you still pay it some attention. Listening to Papa Roach and Evanescence. That Laffy Taffy lean with it, skeet skeet. Another lame single every day of the week. Fuck radio for what it does and doesn't do. And if you like that shit, then fuck you too.